Hello, and welcome to worship. I want to share with you that Jesus' parable about the two sons who don't do what they say reveals surprises in the reign of God. We can also see in the reading from Ezekiel that the people claim the ways of the Lord are unfair, while God offers repentance and new life. Then I will read to you that Paul urges us to look to Christ as a model of humility, putting the interests of others above our own. Therefore, nourished by the broken bread and shared cup of communion, we offer our lives for the sake of all who are needy in this world. So the Holy Spirit calls us together as the people of God. So let us prepare ourselves for worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. And God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit so that we may confess our sin and receive your forgiveness and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. So now let us together confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord. Kyrie eleison.
dear friends, Kyrie eleison. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. We're going to move to our first reading being from Philippians chapter 2. Paul said, if then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Jesus Christ, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should be bent in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The word of the Lord. And thanks be to God. Our next reading is the Gospel from Matthew chapter 21. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, by what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? Jesus said to them, I will ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? And they argued with one another. If we say from heaven, he will say to us, why then did you not believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And he said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons, and he went to the first and said, son, go and work in the vineyard today. He answered, I will not. But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second son and said the same. And he answered, I go, sir. But he did not go. Jesus asked, which of the two did the will of his father? And they said, the first. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. The Gospel of the Lord, and praise to you, O Christ. So, doing this for the first time, I want to bid you a good morning. Do you know that snowflakes are one of nature's most fragile things? But yet, just look at what they can do when they stick together. Well, today we are going to talk about sticking together. We're going to talk about the joy of unity as explored from the book of Philippians. But let's be clear. We are not talking about unity. We're talking about unity, not uniformity. Uniformity is the result of pressure from the outside. True spiritual unity comes from within. It's a matter of the heart, a heart that has been touched by Christ. Well, first, let us look back at the first chapter of Philippians. The first 26 verses of chapter 1 included personal words from Paul about himself and his feelings. They are both about his experience with the Philippi believers. In chapter 1, verse 27, Paul shifts his focus from himself to them. He begins to address some issues that had arisen in the church that threatened to do damage to the church and their witnesses for Christ. Friends, that is serious business. You see, the Philippians were facing conflict inside the church due to some people who were fussing with each other, if you will. There was also some opposition outside the church due to the threat of false teachers and due to the Philippians' unwillingness to worship the emperor. And yeah, we have politics here. Both the internal conflict and the external opposition then being matched with the persecution or serious issues that must be addressed for these people. And one of the main reasons that they need to be addressed is because they had the potential to do serious damage to the unity of the church. Well, verse 27 in the NIV reads, "Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ." Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. This verse is Paul challenging the church to remember that whatever happens, they need to stay in close fellowship with the Lord and in close fellowship with one another. In one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side in the body of Christ. Now we then move to chapter 2. We see Paul beginning to lovingly guide his brothers and sisters in Christ toward the necessary ingredients for healing the internal wounds that were festering in the church. Paul lets them know that if they are going to make progress in dealing with this conflict, they had to be unified in mind, in love, and soul. The Philippian church must humbly place the interests of their fellow believers above their own interests. Paul connects the outside conflict with the inside conflict, with the word. Therefore, which starts the new paragraph delivered that we have in chapter 2. See, this could be appropriate time to share that when you see the word therefore in the Bible, we must ask, what's the therefore there for? You see, the word therefore is given by Paul in order to say to the Philippians, you are in this battle with me against the opponents outside this church. The church, the universal church. Therefore, you need to make sure that you're in unity with one another inside the church. We've got enough to deal with outside these four walls in the church, so let us make sure we are getting it right inside the body of Christ. So let us pause here. What is the body of Christ? Well, a very prominent image for the church is in the New Testament, the body of Christ. This is especially expressed in Romans 12 and in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, where Paul emphasizes the unity of the church, that we are many parts of one body. And this image brings out the dynamics of diversity that seem to so relevant for the church in its present context. The many parts of the body are all different from each other, yet are all necessary. The hand cannot say to the foot, I do not need you. Well, one of my favorite authors, as you'll get to know in person, is Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He reminds us that the unity of the church as a body of Christ is not a goal to be attained, but a fact to be recognized. We do not have to strive to become the body of Christ. It's through baptism, the water and the word, that we are part of the body of Christ. We are all part of one body, whether we realize it or not, all having different special gifts to be used for the ministry of the church. But what happens to one of us affects the whole body, whether we realize it or not. And the mission of the church, according to this image, is not to achieve unity, but to act as the unified entity that we are. This image also implies that the church embodies Christ's continuing presence in the world, and therefore acts as Christ in the world. We at Trinity know that the church serves the world as Christ served and suffered in the world. In many ways, the mission of the church as the body of Christ is simply to continue doing what Jesus did. We must realize that this doesn't mean being in total agreement with each other on every subject. We all know that there can be disagreements in the church and in the world. So let us understand that having the same mind doesn't mean blind agreement on every subject and issue. It means to be united in our purpose, in our motivation within the church. So that we can ask, what is our purpose? We're not a country club, are we? Well, here at Trinity, our purpose is to live out Jesus' life by fulfilling the Great Commission and the Great Commandment. The Great Commission that we hear in Matthew 28 is to share the gospel and baptize. And just today, I got a phone call to do two more baptisms in the coming weeks. And then the Great Commandment from Matthew 22, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. That is living together in the body of Christ. How inspiring is that? How motivating is that to continue doing what we are already doing and to make it better the best we can, using all our talents, all our gifts, being one, in one mind, in one spirit, in one heart, as several parts of the body of Christ. Then we ask, well, what is our motivation? Well, I believe that we are motivated by our love for God and our desire to glorify God. And we can have differing opinions about how to accomplish this task or purpose, and our purpose and motivation, but we are called to be united, to be united in our desire to fulfill our purpose and our motivation. And that is done through love. And you know, we've heard it, Paul mentions love throughout this letter. Chapter 1, 9, shared, it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more. And in chapter 2, Paul shared, if then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love. Any consolation from love. Any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. And to me, that's incredible, because there's so much meat to chew on here, isn't there? Well, one question that immediately came to my mind was, what does it mean for us to have the same love? Well, let's compare the love that Christians have with the love that the world has. World's love is all about what I can take or what I can get out of it. You'll hear, I will love you if you'll do something for me or give me something. It's a self-centered, what's in it for me kind of love, which, my friends, is not really love at all, is it? We will now return to what we have discussed the last couple of weeks, the Christian love, agape, all about what I can give to you for you. It's selfless, sacrificial, full of goodness and giving. It models itself after Jesus and his unconditional and unending and unmerited love. You see, the world's love is based on feelings, which many people have experienced changing in an instant, based on circumstances. And we have probably heard in the movies or even on television, I don't feel any love for you anymore. Well, contrasting that, Christian love is based on God's unchanging nature. As heard in 1 John 4, we love because God first loved us. And I use that a lot during marital counseling. So if I love of the world shown towards those who may merely be deemed worthy, unconditional Christian love is shown toward everyone, as we heard, even our enemies. See, love in the body of Christ is changed by the love Jesus has, and having that love in our lives through each other. If we are to love as God loves, that love, agape, comes from its source, which is God. And that is how we have unity in the same love. Through the waters of baptism, through prayer, through worship, and just through God's unconditional grace. So here we move from Paul's message, from his authority to a higher authority. Friends, God's love, God's authority blesses us with the gift of forgiveness. Grace abounds thanks to the authority of God and the authority of the gospel, the word made flesh. And we are given a hint of the authority in the gospel today, as Jesus doesn't speak of, but utilizes God's authority given to him as that love, as he silences adversaries, the same ones that hunt him down in the coming days. You see, we need to remember that Jesus came to fulfill the law that the chief priests were attempting to trick him with, to incriminate himself with. So what comes out here is that God does not notice roles of people, the role that we would fulfill. But God realizes, understands our hearts. Just as Paul had been alluding to the Philippians for weeks now. He said the tax collectors and prostitutes are representing the entirety of those typically considered beyond the scope of entering the kingdom of God ahead of those chief priests, the rulers, in their own culture. It's not instead of them. But while this precludes the rulers entering first, as they had expected, after all, they are the chief priests and the leaders of the people. Yet, Jesus does not banish them. So even despite their shortcoming, there is still room for them. Still room, that is, for those who have been corrupted by power. Room even those who neglect their duties or perhaps even exploit their stations. Room for those who reject Christ's words and deeds, just as they rejected John's. Thus, there is room, that is, for all people. Even amid the height of Jesus' struggle with his adversaries, even in the last week of his life that we're reading about, even as he faces betrayal, accusations, desertion, crucifixion, Jesus imagines room in the kingdom of God where anyone will imagine or have the right to expect. And that's this particular time seems like awfully good news, doesn't it? Friends, let us take note of the lesson both Jesus and Paul gives the world. Be the body of Christ and love all people because that is the gift we are given. Even those that can be difficult at times, or those that could possibly or even have hurt us. We've talked about that this past week, haven't we? Because we empty ourselves, as Jesus did, as Paul did, as we are called to do, so that we may be open spiritually to all people, unconditionally, unconditional love that God has for us. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So at this time, let us come together as one church and pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I now want to play for you Blessed Assurance, but by Elevation Worship. So now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May his Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord upon you with favor and give you all peace. Amen. You are all now entering God's mission field, so go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.